Welcome back, my friends. Currently, we're on day 190 of Russia's disastrous invasion of Ukraine, and the top story has to be the continued counteroffensive by the Ukrainian military in the Kherson region. Now, the Ukrainian Armed Forces has requested that people not post information, pictures, or videos of the counteroffensive for operational security to protect their soldiers. So I won't do any of that in this video, but I can still generally talk about what's happening with this counteroffensive. And according to the United States, some Russian units are falling back in Kherson. The Pentagon acknowledges Ukrainian breakthroughs as a result of its offensive in the south around Kherson. And sure enough, immediately after posting my video 2 days ago saying that the counteroffensive had begun, Russian trolls and Russian bots immediately started spamming my channel, saying that the counteroffensive had already failed. Let me read these two comments for you. From what I've heard so far, the whole counteroffensive has failed. The Ukrainians lost over 1,200 troops and 120 armored vehicles. Massive failure. Ukrainian counteroffensive has been failed. Russia will win, inshallah. Love from Bangladesh for Russian shoulders. Russian shoulders. So that's not how a counteroffensive works, and the standard by which we're going to judge the Ukrainian military will be the Russian military. It took the Russian military 3 months to take the city of Mariupol and 4 months to take the city of Severodonetsk. So a single week or two into the war, the Russian military was just outside of the city of Severodonetsk. It then took them 4 months to successfully take the city. If Russian supporters are arguing that that was a successful offensive, then a successful counteroffensive to retake the city of Kherson, I'm giving the Ukrainian military 4 months to do it. I don't think it's going to take that long. I think fighting will continue over the next couple weeks. But eventually, the 20,000, 25,000 Russian soldiers, they will either be captured, killed, or forced to retreat on foot to get to the south bank of the river. And the reason why is they are completely cut off. They're not getting resupplied. Every time a Russian soldier fires a bullet, they're not getting any more bullets. Every time they turn on their vehicle, they're not getting any more gasoline. Every time they eat breakfast, lunch, or dinner, they're not getting any more food or ration supplies. The Ukrainians have completely cut off these Russian soldiers, and it's up to them how long they want to hold out when they can't be resupplied. So we know things are not looking good for the Russian forces in the city of Kherson, because the Russian-appointed civilian head of the city, Stremasov, has fled the city of Kherson to go back to Russia. What he did is he posted a video on social media with a window behind him, and in the background you could identify a church, and someone figured it out that he filmed this video from his hotel room at a Marriott in the city of Voronezh, Russia. And this is not even within HIMARS striking of Ukrainian territory, so this guy doesn't want anything to do with the city of Kherson anymore. If he had confidence that the Russian military could hold the city, he'd be doing his job, you know, being the administrator of this town. And we are getting social media posts from Russian soldiers on the north bank of the river, completely panicking and freaking out. And this was posted on a Russian social media site. The situation is extremely difficult. The bridges across the Dnieper do not function. In fact, the grouping of our direction is now cut off from constant supply, and there are heavy losses. So the Antonovsky Bridge keeps getting bombed over and over again. They bombed the bridge, they bombed the pontoon bridge. I'm pretty confident at this point they've bombed the ferries as well. So no supplies, nothing is getting across this river. And with Russian losses, Russian casualties, Russian wounded piling up, for those soldiers, they have to ask themselves, do they want to stick it out there and fight to the last man? And here is a map showing the location of 48 separate HIMARS strikes against Russian forces just between the days of August 29th and August 31st. As you can see, they're concentrating their fire on the city of Kherson, as well as Nova Kakhovka around this hydroelectric power plant. Now, Russia is always claiming that they've destroyed all of these HIMARS launchers, and yet Ukraine is still using them in operation. How can we explain this conflicting information? And Ukraine has finally admitted that they've been using wood decoys of HIMARS launchers to deliberately get Russia to fire and waste expensive cruise missiles. Maybe a single cruise missile cost Russia $6 million. And all they're doing is destroying about $300 worth of lumber and paint. I think this is pretty innovative, pretty creative. Fire the HIMARS from a certain location, then nearby leave a dummy wooden decoy to be blown up by the Russians checking their satellites. A+ to this strategy. Now, big picture, I've been getting comments, Jake, why are the Ukrainians destroying the bridges? Aren't they going to need those bridges to get across themselves in order to retake this southern region? And big picture, big strategy, what is occurring here? The Ukrainians need to kick the Russians off the north bank so that they themselves can redeploy their forces over here. So if the Russians do successfully retreat, this river will become a natural barrier in which neither side is going to be able to cross. So if the Russians pull back, the Ukrainians will then fortify the north bank, but they're not going to attempt to cross the river. You'd have to build a pontoon bridge. The chance of success is very low. So what the Ukrainians would do is they would redirect their forces across the river somewhere where it's safe, and then redeploy those troops along this eastern front. More than likely, the next offensive would occur somewhere near Zaporizhia, and Ukraine would probably push down to Melitopol. We don't know the timetable for this. Once again, this counteroffensive in Kherson could take weeks or even months. Ukraine's Air Force is still flying combat missions over the skies of Ukraine. A Ukrainian Air Force pilot released a stunning cockpit video of himself flying MiG-29s, showing them firing AGM-88 anti-radiation missiles at Russian positions. This video is about a minute and a half long. Let's watch it together. This is absolutely incredible that the Ukrainian Air Force is still taking off and landing and flying combat missions over the skies of Ukraine 6 months into this war. How embarrassing or laughable is it for the Russian military that they have not been able to locate and destroy all of these planes? And I've argued for 190 days now that this war is not going well for Russia. And it looks like the Russian defense minister, Sergei Shoigu, has finally been sidelined and ridiculed by Putin. Putin can't fire and replace him because that would be admitting that the war is not going well. But Sergei is no longer allowed to talk about or make decisions concerning this war. He's been replaced by other Russian generals. And the Kremlin released this hilarious video of a National Guard boss briefing Putin at his desk. Top Russian general filmed lying to Putin's face in an awkward briefing. This clip is about 30 seconds long. I want you to watch this and just look at the body language of this Russian general and Vladimir Putin's reaction to him.
Росгвардійці виконують задачі по охороні важливих государственних об'єктів, об'єктів інформаційної інфраструктури, непосередньо комунікаційних інфраструктур, обеспечення гуманітарної безпеки, проведення грузів, супроводження їх. Также мы занимаемся медицинским обеспечением населения и просто оказываем медицинскую помощь населению. Вот тот круг задач, который мы осуществляем. Я особо хочу подчеркнуть, что мы чувствуем поддержку населения.
So this Russian general is nervously fidgeting his thumbs in his lap. He also can't maintain eye contact with Vladimir Putin. Meanwhile, we switch the camera to Putin, and he still does not look good. Bad posture in the chair. Puffy neck, you can see on his face he's not happy with what he's hearing, and once again, with his right hand, he is using it to grip the table to stop his hand from involuntarily shaking. So the Kremlin, I mean, if this is the video they're putting out, I'm curious to see what kind of videos they filmed where they say, we can't release this to the public. Here's a sad story. A survey or some kind of study was done to determine, to estimate what was the casualty count of civilians killed in the city of Mariupol. And according to city morticians, based on bodies brought in, it's estimated that the Russian military killed about 87,000 civilians. For 3 months, the city was under siege and brutalized as the Russian forces surrounded it and then didn't allow civilians to evacuate. There were lots of civilians that wanted to get out of the city as the city didn't have clean drinking water or food supplies or electricity. And the Russian military just systematically bombed and destroyed every building in the town, killing whoever was sheltering inside. I'll link the Ukrainian article down below if you want to read more about it. And in the last 3 months, since Russia got control of the city, they've been doing everything they can to cover up their war crimes. The most tragic one of all is this drama theater in Mariupol, in which several hundred children were sheltering inside on the roof of the building and in front of the building so you could see it from space. It was labeled, "Children are sheltering here." The Russian military bombed it anyways. And it's reported that construction workers at the site were ordered not to pull out bodies, but to just pour concrete over everything, once again to cover up the war crimes. So let's talk about Russian state media and how they're reacting to this war. And amid the ongoing debate of a possible EU tourist visa ban for Russia, Russian state TV is freaking out and calling themselves the victims, and they're now claiming that the Russians, that Russian people, are now the new Jews of Europe. Incredible. Let's watch this clip together.
Новые статистические данные указывают на то, что еще больше русских людей осознали, что другого выбора у нашей страны не было и нет до сих пор, и война сейчас ведется не с Украиной, война на выживание, или мы их, или они нас, а те уже не стесняются. Осталось выдать нам звезды, разместить их где-нибудь на предплечье и сказать, что...
And we say now that Russians are the new Jews of Europe because they're being so oppressed, so discriminated against by all those Nazis in Europe. All Russia's done is invaded their neighbor, kill a couple hundred thousand innocent civilians. And mind you, Mariupol was the ethnic Russian, Russian-speaking town of Ukraine. The Donbas region is where the ethnic Russians live. Russia doesn't care about any of these people. And then they go on state TV and claim they're the victim. They're the ones being oppressed. They are now the new Jews of Europe. Wow. A famous Russian actress by the name of Kristina Asmuth is being persecuted by Putin's fascist regime. On Instagram on February 24th, when the war began, she posted, "Fear and pain, I beg you, stop all of this, no to war." 6 months later, Putin is wrapping up loose ends and charging her with discrediting the army. She seems like a lovely lady. I checked her out on IMDb and I've never heard of her before or seen any of her movies, but this is what life is like in fascist Russia. If you posted something 6 months ago, eventually the FSB is going to show up at your house. And if just arresting you and prosecuting you is all they do, consider yourself lucky. A Russian oil boss who opposed the Ukraine war dies after suddenly falling out of a window. So a Russian oil executive whose company opposed Russia's invasion of Ukraine has reportedly died after falling from a window in Moscow on Thursday. Ravil Magnov, 67, chairman of Russia's second largest oil producer, Lukoil, was found dead after suddenly falling from his sixth floor window. This is what life is like in fascist Russia. Let's now pivot and talk about some good news for Ukraine, as Ukraine's Daria Snigur stuns the world by upsetting the number 7th ranked female tennis player in the world at the US Open. If you've never heard of her, I mean, I don't think many people outside of Ukraine probably has heard of her. She was only ranked 124th in the world. She's only 20 years old. Here is the moment at the US Open when she won this incredible upset match. Absolutely incredible story. She's only 20 years old. She could have an incredible tennis career ahead of herself. Final video I want to share with you is of a Ukrainian soldier who proposed to his girlfriend, and she's a journalist, and at the time she was live streaming her show. He called in and surprised her. I just want to share this incredible clip with you.
Я хочу, щоб ти завжди дивилася своїми очками-сеневирками в мої очі кольору шоколаду. Щоб ми створили із наших двох незалежностей одну величезну незалежність. І за нами велика відповідальність, адже попереду ще перемога. І це наша спільна перемога усієї нації, усієї країни і нашого особисто з тобою. Твій люблячий Лемко хоче взяти тебе за жону. Як ти до того ставишся? Підходить?
Мені все з тобою підходить.
Ти мій метеорит.
Я тебе люблю. Це означає так, означає стота.
She said yes. I'm just a sucker for these kind of marriage proposals. That's all for this update video. Glory to the heroes, glory to Ukraine. If you found this video informative, give me a thumbs up. Best way to support my channel. Comments or questions, let me know down below. I love hearing from you guys. Till the next video, take care, be safe.